Well, good morning. Welcome to this digital service of Wellsboro Bible Church. We're so glad that you've joined us together online. Many of you are already on, and we're just so thankful to be able to do this, to praise the Lord that we can have this technology where we can come together and worship the Lord. Now, some of you are, maybe you just got out of bed a little while ago, you're wearing your pajamas. Some of you are still dressed for church. Josh, can you put that picture up of Denny Bliss? There it is. So he's got his tie, but he is wearing jeans. It's a little casual. Thanks, Josh. Thank you, Denny, for showing, for doing that, for posting that for us. Now, if you are online with us, can you please put a comment in the chat? Just say hello. Let us know who's with you, whether that's your family or you've been able to invite a couple folks in your groups of 10 over. We would just love to see kind of who's present. Say hello. Feel free to comment throughout the service. If you want to say amen to something or comment on something that TJ says, please do so. We would love for you to be able to participate as much as possible. And the chat is in the bottom bar. Now, you also have a bulletin available electronically. That's going to have our order of service that will help guide you as we flow through this. It's also going to have discussion questions at the end that you can feel free to discuss with your family and those whom you're with after this simulcast is over. You can find that bulletin on our website, wellsborobible.com. It's right in the front main page. You can also find it in our WBC Facebook page, and you should have gotten it in your email last night or this morning as well. Now, one announcement to make is that our Ladies Bible Study was originally scheduled to meet this Monday, actually tomorrow. We've postponed that 1 week. It'll begin the following Monday through Zoom as well. And Janet will be leading that. Pray for Janet. Pray for the preparation of the study. And if you need to get connected, please talk to Janet about that. If you need the book, that can be picked up here at the church. It can also be ordered on Amazon. And on our website, there's a link under the Women's Ministry tab to where you can purchase that book. Now, the church continues to have financial needs through this global crisis. We believe that giving is just as much a part of worship. It's just as much a spiritual discipline as prayer and Bible reading is. And we give out of a response to who Christ is and to the gospel, that he came into this world and died for our sins so that we could be freed from condemnation. He paid such a great debt. And out of the joy of what he has done for us, we are called to give joyfully. You can do that electronically on our website. There's a giving tab, or you could pay with a credit card. If you're uncomfortable with giving online, feel free to come by the church office or send a check in the mail. And we're so thankful that the members of this church, by the grace of God, have been able to sustain this church financially for over 100 years. And we're so thankful. We look forward to the future in what God will continue to do through this church. Now let's take a moment to quietly in our seats reflect on the Lord and prepare our hearts to worship the living God, and I will break that silence with his word. Psalm 95, verse 6. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. And that is what we plan to do this morning. Let's worship the King of Heaven. Let's give him praise. And as we do that, we're going to ask Joe Lewis to pray a prayer of praise in response to who God is.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Please join me in a prayer of praise to our Lord and Savior. Father God, we come before you this morning humbly, Lord. We know that you are omniscient and omnipotent, Lord. Nothing happens in this world that you're not in control of and that you knew that surprises you, Lord. Lord, these times that we're facing as a country right now, people are easily frightened and it's easy for people to forget that you are in control, Lord. But Lord, we are just so grateful that nothing surprises you. You were in control when Christ was hung on the cross, Lord, and you're in control right now. Lord, we thank you for all of that. Lord, we actually thank you right now, Lord, for the opportunity to reach people who are questioning and fearful. This is such an opportunity for us to show you and your glory to this world and to one another. Let us serve each other and praise you through all things and in all ways. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, if you're at home sitting down, could you stand up and sing, "Oh, Worship the King, the God of Heaven"? This is a standing up kind of song as we just gather and we praise the name of Jesus Christ.
Oh, worship the King, all glorious above. Gratefully sing his wonderful love. Our shield, our defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise. Tell of his might, tell of his might, sing of his grace, whose robe is the light. Canopy spaced, his chariots of wrath, the deep thunderclouds form, and dark is his path on the wings of the storm.
Let's respond, sing, "You alone."
And you alone are the matchless King, to you alone be all majesty. Your glories and wonders, what tongue can recite? You breathe in the air, you shine in the light. Measureless might, ineffable love, while angels delight to worship above. Thy mercies how tender, how firm to the end. A maker, defender, redeemer, and friend.
Let's respond, "You alone."
You alone are the matchless King, to you alone be all majesty. Your glories and wonders, what tongue can recite? You breathe in the air, you shine in the light. You alone, oh, you alone are the matchless King, to you alone be all majesty. Your glories and wonders, what tongue can recite? You breathe in the air, you shine in the light. You shine in the light.
He is the light of the world.
You shine in the light.
Lift up your voice in your home.
Oh, worship the King, all glorious above. And gratefully sing of his wonderful love. Our shield, our defender, the Ancient of Days, pavilioned in splendor and girded with praise.
It's good to worship together this morning. Our God is sovereign, watching over us. Just like we learned this morning in Psalm 139, he loves us very much and he knows us, each one of us. So we're going to sing of his love this morning.
Thank you.
beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory.
Boast in Christ this morning.
I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom.
Boast in Christ.
But I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection.
Why should I gain?
Why should
this morning again.
On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand.
May you stand on Christ this morning.
I know that this trial has impacted many of you in very different ways. For some, it has not been so terrible at this point. For some of you, it's been very difficult. Nonetheless, we worship and serve the King. This was no surprise to our God. And the Lord has even used these trials for his glory throughout history. I mean, I can't imagine what it was like for the church to go through the plagues and through fierce persecution that they found in the very early church. And so the Lord is faithful in the midst of this, and he calls us to be a church who loves one another and reflects his glory to the world. Romans chapter 12 is one of those chapters that speaks so deeply about how the church should act in love toward one another during these trials. So Jody is going to read that passage with us.
Romans 12, 9 through 13. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not be slothful in zeal. Be fervent in the spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints and seek to show hospitality.
Amen. Thank you, Jody. At this time, TJ is going to come forward for a pastoral prayer as we recognize the needs of our own congregation and gospel impact in the world.
Well, good morning, church. It's so good to worship with you this morning, even though we are not physically together. We're connected through this wonderful tool, and it really is a blessing. So for this pastoral prayer, I want to specifically pray for some of the needs of our body during this time. I want to pray for God's sovereign will for the entire creation. And I want to pray for some other churches in the area as well. So would you join me in praying? Our sovereign God, we come before you this morning humbled by our frailty. We're just so aware in a time like this of how we've placed our confidence in so many things that truly will not last. As we think about the word that we have proclaimed and trusted and the reality that we've declared our hope to be in you, when we're shaken like this, we realize just in how many subtle ways we've not made that true. We actually have put hope in our health and in our finances, in the government's ability to keep us, in an economic system that seems to be working flawlessly, normally. Lord, so many things we've just taken for granted, and we've failed to praise you for them. We've also failed to recognize that our hope shouldn't be in them. And so we come before you primarily asking for your forgiveness and declaring once again with confidence and boldness and with new meaning that you are Lord, you are sovereign, you are good, and we depend on you. And so I think of some of the brothers and sisters in our own church who are laid off right now because of the economic troubles. I pray that you would help them financially to be able to make ends meet and to be able to have the food and supplies that they need and to be able to keep purchasing those provisions. I pray for those who have seen their retirement accounts just dwindle rapidly. Some of them, Lord, it was already stretching thin, and now it's really scary. We pray that you would not allow them to get worried as they look at their bank accounts, but instead that they would look at you, who owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, who truly provides for every one of our needs. God, I think of those who are working, nurses, doctors, those who have other career fields where they're likely to come into direct contact with people who are sick. We ask for their safety, that you would give them confidence that you've called them to this kind of work, that they would not shrink back at it now that it is especially difficult, and that they would bring gospel hope to sick people in the midst of this. Lord, I think of the school teachers and a number of others who are in an especially difficult time because they don't even know what the end of their school year looks like. They haven't had an opportunity to connect in a way that they normally would with their students. They've poured their hearts and their souls into this year, and they're just not even sure what to do right now. So comfort them. Help the administration to make wise decisions. Be with the school board as they think through how to respond to this. Thank you for the way that already there's been a blessing in our community as people have gathered and rallied around serving lunches. Lord, we ask that you would help us as a church. Father, would you sustain us as we worship apart from one another? We know that this isn't a gathering. This isn't an assembly like we're called. This is a connecting that's happening online, for which we're so thankful. But God, would you keep in front of us the privilege that it is to gather? And Lord, we so look forward to doing that again, hopefully very soon. In the meantime, would you help us to stay connected and to care for one another? Thank you for the many ways that members of our church have already reached out and cared for each other and for the community. Lord, would you help us to demonstrate the love of Christ through the way we love one another, as you've called us to do. And Father, I think of a number of other churches in our area and around the world who are struggling. Lord, this morning specifically, I want to pray for one of our sister churches, Covington Baptist Church, as they also have a remote service. Lord, I pray that that church as well would be just focused on the gospel. Thank you for their good leadership through Adam and Dennis. You've blessed them so much with good shepherds. And I just pray that they would be united and focused on you. And again, Lord, for the many other churches in our region and throughout the world who are struggling, give us the confidence to really believe that if the gates of hell won't prevail against your church, this virus won't either. We pray that your gospel would just go forth so abundantly as a result of this. We love you, Lord, and we pray that you would help us. In Christ's name, amen. Actually, at this time, I would like to turn your attention back to the screens. Also, if you weren't able to access those bulletins yet, they are on Facebook and they are in your email. It's really helpful if you're having difficulty at all seeing the screens that you could just look right inside the bulletin there. We're going to sing a song that, again, I think will take on new meaning today as we recognize the world around us has been grinding to a halt. Things that we normally trust, we just aren't able to. Friends, that is such a good thing because it is only our Lord who can hold us fast. So let's sing with great confidence now. He will hold me fast.
When I fear my faith will fail, Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, thank you.
will hold you fast.
Well, this time we're going to pray for Pastor TJ as he comes forward to unpack God's word. Heavenly Father, your word gives light. It illumines our hearts. It brings the truth to bear. It convicts us of sin. It shows us the way. It is the true path. And we pray that you would speak through your word this morning as we study you, as we study who you are, your omniscience, your omnipresence, that you are here with us. And we pray that you would be glorified in your word today. We pray that your word, as scripture promises us, would not return void, but will serve its purpose. And that your spirit would work through your word. We pray for TJ as he comes forward. And I pray that you would speak through him boldly. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your goodness. And in Jesus' name, amen.
Well, thanks, Mike. If you've been around the church for a while, you remember Mike had the great sermon illustration about how our life is a vapor. I'd like my vapor life to be a little cleaner. I don't know what kind of germs he brought up here. Well, if you have your Bible, turn to Psalm 139. Psalm 139. I'm going to read the psalm and then we'll pray and walk through it together. Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in, behind me and before, and lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain it. Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as the day, for darkness is as light with you. For you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret. Intricately woven in the depths of the earth. You saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I would count them, they're more than the sand. I awake and I'm still with you. Oh, that you would slay the wicked, O God. O men of blood, depart from me. They speak against you with malicious intent. Your enemies take your name in vain. Do I not hate those who hate you, O Lord? And do I not loathe those who rise up against you? I hate them with complete hatred. I count them my enemies. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts, and see if there's any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Let's ask for the Lord's help as we study this psalm together. Father, you have searched us. You have known us. You've known us completely. You knew before we were born what we would face today. You have never left us. Your presence is always with us. Your watchful eye never leaving us. There's nowhere we could go to hide from it. There's no circumstance we could face that would make you distant. So we recognize even this morning that you are here, and for that we praise you. God, I ask for your help as I preach this word. Would you help us as a congregation to understand it, to apply it, to cling to the hope that is here, and to live as the psalmist saying, continue to search me, O God. Know my heart, try me, and help me to live according to your will and way. Help us now, God, in Jesus' name, amen. Well, to help us understand this passage, I have created a statement that's inside your notes. And if you'll look inside the bulletin, you'll see it there. It'll also be on the screen. The statement is, I will live for God, who knows me and always sees me, because I belong to him. Josh, is there a way we could actually put that onto the screen?
I just sent it in the chat.
Oh, it's in the chat. The statement is, I will live for God, who knows me and always sees me, because I belong to him. Friends, in a time like this, we could use a little bit of comfort. I remember being a child, and there were times where I would be frustrated or fearful, feeling alone. And one of the most comforting things would be to have someone who loved me, like a parent, come to me and tell me, hey, everything is okay. I'm with you. I know you, I love you. Those kinds of words are so encouraging in times of trouble and fear. That's why I selected Psalm 139 for our text this morning, because the Lord knows us in a way that is deeper than we even understand. And his love for us is immeasurable, and it is good for us to take comfort there this morning. And so the first point in your notes under that statement is this. It is that God knows me. God knows me. The psalm starts out, to the choir master, a psalm of David. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. So right away in this text, we see the reality that the psalmist is taking comfort in the fact that God knows him. But it's a fully known kind of knowing. God has searched him or examined him completely. This is not some kind of casual acquaintance or God is aware of you or God watches you like Santa Claus keeping a list of your goods and your bads. No, God has fully examined you. He's searched you and he knows you. Verse 2. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path, my lying down. You're acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it all together. And the point is so clear. God knows you better than you know yourself. You don't even know what you're going to say next, and it's already known to the Lord. He is always with us. He always sees us. He knows what we're going to do tomorrow, a year from now. He knows the end of our life. He knows the whole story. That's the idea you get in verse 5. It says, you hem me in behind me and before me, and you lay your hand upon me. This gives us the idea that God is behind us with a record of everything that we've ever done. And then he is before us, knowing what we're going to do before we even do it. And all the while, even now, in this moment, God's hand is upon us. He sees us. He's acquainted with us fully, even now. We're hemmed in by him, and his hand is upon us. Now, for some of us, this should actually be not so much a comforting thought, but a scary thought. Because you know some of the things you've done in your past. You know some of the things that you think about now that aren't good. And you can probably assume that your future will include some things that are not honoring to the Lord. So the fact that he sees us constantly, that we're hemmed in by him, could also almost make a sinner feel claustrophobic. There's nowhere I can go to escape the judgment of God. And that's exactly true. But for some reason here, the psalmist isn't frightened. Look what he exclaims in verse 6. He says, "Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain it." The reality for the Christian, knowing that God knows everything about us, even things we don't know, is not meant to be something that would cause us to fear. It's something that should bring us comfort. Friend, your God knows the very things that scare you. He knows what tempts you. He knows what you're talking about and what you're thinking about. And you can let your soul, like the psalmist, be lifted by the reality that you are intimately known by the creator and the sustainer of the whole universe. I don't know what your political leanings are, but right now in the midst of this crisis, I want you to imagine what it would be like for the president of the United States to call you on the phone and say, "Hey, I just want you to know that in the midst of this crisis, I'm thinking about you. I have your best interest in mind. I have your health history right here. I'm going to make sure that there's nothing with this virus that harms you in any way. All of my policies are going to be geared toward you." That would be a pretty shocking thing to have happen. Well, you know what's really shocking? The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the one who makes presidents and national leaders look like nothing, he actually does know you that well, and he cares about you deeply. The president walking through this doesn't even know you exist. He's probably never seen your name on a list. He knows nothing about you. God knows everything about you, and he's far more powerful than any president. Church, you can place your whole confidence in him and be comforted by the reality that he knows you, he loves you, and he truly is working all things together for your good, not to harm you. God doesn't only know you. Even now, God sees you. And that leads to the second point that's in your notes and will be in the chat. And that is that God always sees me. God always sees me. Verse 7. "Where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence?" So the psalmist here is just trying to imagine, is there anywhere I could go or anything I could do that would escape the sight of the Lord? And he starts giving some extreme examples. Verse 8. "If I ascend to the heaven, you're there." I mean, obviously, no man can take himself into heaven. Here, this is probably referring to the highest parts of the atmosphere. Even that, especially in this time, no man had the ability to ascend there. The psalmist knows this, but he's still saying, "Even if I could get there, you're already there, Lord." He goes on to say, "If I make my bed in Sheol," which is probably a reference to the grave, certainly death, "you are there." So the psalmist is recognizing that even if I leave this life and go into the next, God is there too. Verse 9, "If I take the wings of morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me." To this day, mankind is not able to get to the deepest depths of the sea. But would we be able to get there, God would be there, and he would still be leading us and guiding us. Friends, God's presence covers the earth. It extends beyond this world to the universe. It extends beyond this life to the next. God is everywhere, omnipresent, and you are never alone and never without him. Do not allow your mind to trick you into believing he's left you. He's forgotten you. He's forsaken you. He can't, and he won't. Verse 11, If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light with you. There's been a few times in my life where it's been so dark, it almost felt suffocating. Where you can't see your hand in front of your face, and if you needed to walk somewhere, you'd have a very difficult time getting there. Well, even in those darkest moments, God sees as though it were daylight. Even the dark is light to him. In the midst of your darkest day, in the darkest trial of your soul, God sees through it all plainly. There is no fog or cloudiness or confusion with God. No, his watchful and guiding eye is constantly on you. There may be times that you feel lost or alone, but you actually have the King of Kings with you always. But the question is, why does God do this? Why does he know us intimately? Why does he always watch over us? I mean, I already said the President of the United States doesn't even know your name. Why does the King of Kings care about you? Well, that's because of the third point that you'll see in your notes and in the chat. And that is that God owns me. God owns me. Verse 13 starts with one of my favorite words, for. It's kind of like the word therefore or because. It says, for you formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. Verse 15, my frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. You saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there were none of them. Brothers and sisters, before God formed the earth, he already knew you. Before the foundations of the earth were laid, you were already on his mind. And at just the right moment, exactly when he intended, according to the purposes of his eternal plans, he allowed you to be conceived. And while you were in your mother's womb, God was at work, knitting you together exactly how he wanted you to be. He's the one who encoded your DNA. He's the one who made you look like you look. He's the one who made you have the personality that you have. He gave you your shortcomings and your strengths. He decided who your parents would be and where you would be born. God decided when you would be born, even for such a time as this. Friends, this is the reason that life is critical, it's precious from the moment of conception. Because before the foundations of the world were laid, God knew that little baby, and he planned to knit that little baby together in its mother's womb. It's also why your life is precious. Before you were born, God knew exactly what you would face every single day of your life. He knew that you would be alive during this international crisis that we're fumbling through, that no one can remember anything similar happening. And you can take confidence in the reality that still, God will not leave you. He will not forsake you. You were literally made for this. So be reminded, God chose the date of your birth, and he already has the date of your death on his calendar as well. And there's nothing that you can do to change it. This is why Jesus reminds us in Matthew and in Luke that by worrying, we cannot add a single hour to the span of our lives. That's why Job reflects in Job chapter 14 this confession about his frailty. And he remarks that God has already allotted a certain number of days to man, and no man can exceed those days. The fear of death is gone when we understand the sovereignty of God and recognize that Christ has removed the sting of death so that upon our death we can be united with our Father, our Savior, forever. So that's the same idea the psalmist is sharing here when he notes that our days were written in his book even before we were born. This is just meant to give us remarkable comfort, knowing that God is sovereign, he's good, and we actually belong to him. He made us, and therefore he owns us. He has all the stake in our life. God knows what he's doing with the universe, and he knows what he's doing with you. So this morning, why don't we take a deep breath? The world has not gone off script. There's no panic. There's no contingency plan in God's mind. Things are happening exactly as he knew they would happen. And he will work all things together for the good of those who love him. Take hope and comfort in the Lord through this time. The world is his, we are his, and we can rest in his sovereign control. And this leads to our final point. That is that it is God who I'm living for. God is who I'm living for. This is really the response of the psalmist. Look at verse 17. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I would count them, they're more than the sand. I awake and I'm still with you. When the psalmist thinks about the fact that he's known and seen and owned by God, he starts to reflect on God himself. This is the very thing that happens to two people who are falling in love. They didn't know each other. They meet. They realize they like each other. And they start thinking about the other person all the time. They start wondering, I wonder what he's thinking. I wonder what she's thinking right now. And you start to ask each other all kinds of questions. Some couples even spend hours and hours on the phone just trying to learn each other's thoughts, saying how much they love each other. That's a sense of what's happening here with the psalmist. He is so in love with God and moved by God's love for him that he starts thinking about God's thoughts. I want to know what he's thinking. I want to know him more. When he considers it, he's just amazed. God's thoughts are too great to understand. I think about him, it's like trying to think about the sand on the seashore. It's just too vast, too numerous, too amazing for me to get my mind around. And then in the same way, he starts to reflect on those who oppose God. And he gets a little defensive, rightly so. This is a righteous defense that happens in the next four verses. Challenging, but righteous. It says, oh, that you would slay the wicked, O God. O men of blood, depart from me. They speak against you with malicious intent. Your enemies take your name in vain. Do I not hate those who hate you, O Lord? And do I not loathe those who rise up against you? I hate them with complete hatred. I count them as enemies. There is a fury that develops in the heart of someone who watches someone he loves maligned or attacked. I think of a parent who would see a child being attacked unjustly, just this burning anger that would well up within them. There's something similar happening here to the psalmist. When he looks at the world and sees the evil of sin that has captured the hearts of men, and those men rebel and turn against this perfectly loving and gracious God, it just drives him to righteous indignation. I think likewise, when we see God attacked, we feel a same sense of that righteous indignation. And of course, this does not negate the responsibility we have as Christians to show love and benevolence and kindness to the lost. That is not a commentary on how we should relate. But it does show in our hearts when we see our God mocked, it creates within us an anger because of our love for the Lord. One of the things that makes our fellowship so sweet as Christians is that we are a people who are not mocking God, but together confessing our love for him. One of the things that makes coming together on a Sunday morning when we're able to gather so sweet is that we're standing in a room singing praises with other people who love the Lord like we love the Lord. We're hearing from God's word together, corporately taking in the word of God spoken to us, recognizing that it's our hope. We pray together, going before the throne of God boldly because Christ has made it possible for us to approach him in that way. Christian fellowship is so sweet because God has brought together people for his own glory to worship the one who made us and who we love. It's one of the reasons we cannot wait to get back together with you so soon. We start to see the psalmist reflect on not only the past and God's way of knowing him, not only his protection of him, but we start to see that the psalmist wants to live more and more for God's glory, just as we do. Look at verse 23. This is really interesting because the psalm started off that God has searched him. And now in verse 23, he's making the request, search me, O God. He wants God to continue to look at every detail of his life, but there's a reason for it. He says, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. Why? Verse 24, see if there's any grievous or sinful or wrong way in me, and then correct me. Lead me in the way everlasting. This man is so gripped by God's love and protection and care that he doesn't want to step out of bounds and do something that would dishonor the Lord in any way. So he pleads with God, continue to search me, try me, look at my heart, and when you see anything wrong, Lord, would you correct me? One of the ways that the Lord does that is through his word. When we read his word and we see error in our life, the Lord is correcting us by telling us the right thing to do. He uses his spirit to convict our hearts and to help us know whether we're walking in the truth or walking according to sin. He uses other Christians who come into your life and say, hey, here's what the scriptures say. What about this situation in your life? God uses a number of means of grace to accomplish this very thing. Friend, don't give in to the temptation during this crisis to waste your time by sitting and watching binge seasons of something on Netflix or by getting a bunch of projects done that you want to get caught up on. You can do this very thing. You can grow in your walk with the Lord by continuing to allow your heart to be examined through the Word, through the Spirit, on the phone with other Christians. Don't miss that opportunity. Don't neglect your spiritual growth. What we see from the psalmist is that he hates the way of the world, but he loves God and his ways. God's love motivates him to want to live every moment for his glory, no matter the cost. Now, I imagine that there are some of us who don't really want God examining us this deeply. And it's right for us to fear God, because there will be wrath for anyone who has sinned against him. He's going to punish every rebel, and just one sin puts you into that category. But if you are in Christ, there is no reason to fear. All of your sins are washed away, nailed to the cross. You bear them no more. Now we long for God to search our hearts because we know there's no condemnation and we want to be just like the one who made us for his glory. We're his image bearers. We long to walk in a way that reflects him to the world. So invite the Lord to examine you and to help you get rid of anything that is not Christ-like in your life. Don't fear his condemnation or his judgment. Trust in his grace, but long for his refining. That is the heart of the psalmist. So, dear ones, let us take great comfort in the reality that if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, that our hope is in the blood of Christ, which washed our sin away. And let us walk boldly with our Lord, proclaiming him in good times and in bad. For he deserves all the glory. Let's pray together. Lord, Search us. Try us. Know our hearts. When any grievous or offensive ways are demonstrated in the way we think or talk or live, in your kindness, would you make them known to us and help us to turn from them? Use your word and your spirit and other Christians, your church, as a means of grace to help us to walk according to the truth. Father, I pray that every single person tuning into this would have a passion to live for your glory, a confidence in your goodness and your sovereignty, and a boldness to share the hope we have with others. We praise you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, in your homes, if you'd like to rise for our benediction. Now may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and gave us eternal comfort and good hope through grace, comfort your hearts and establish you in every good work and word. Thank you so much for joining us. If you could, please stick around in the chat for a little bit. Greet each other. I know it's a little different than normal, but it's a good way to stay connected with each other. Remember to tune into our church Facebook page, our church website, and your email for further updates. And if you could, take a picture of yourselves this morning and send that over to connect@wellsborobible.com. Thank you for worshiping with us. We'll see you next time.